Hey, good morning, Harvest. Good morning. Come on, let's go ahead and stand together. Glad you made it to church today. It's good to see y'all. Yeah. You know, this week I was listening to a podcast, and I was talking about worship. It was talking about how so often in our songs and churches today, we can be coming to church and we can be asking God, Lord, I know that you've been faithful in the past, so would you be faithful again? And that's a great thing, because we see that in scripture, where you can say, God, would you bring healing in my life to something? And that's a great thing, because we know that that's who he is. That's what he wants to do for his children. But just as many times in Psalms, it says something like in Psalm 100, where it says, enter his courts with thanksgiving, enter his courts with praise. You know, we give adoration to God, we give praise to God, not just because of the things that he does for us, not just because of the things that he promises us, but because he is so worthy. That's just who he is. And so when we give him praise, what we're doing is we're teaching our heart the posture of saying, God, you are so, so great, and I'm gonna do what I'm made to do, what I'm created to do, and I'm gonna awaken my soul, I'm gonna set my heart in the posture of praise towards you. So this morning, whatever you need to do to just get your heart into that posture, if it's taking a second and saying whatever the distractions are, whatever the hurts are, whatever those things are, Lord, I know you're going to minister to those things, but for right now, God, I'm laying them down and I'm going to lift my hands and say that I want to praise you. If it's even taking a deep breath in and just saying, Lord, just as you awakened my body today, as I woke up and got up out of bed and got to church, would you awaken my soul to sing your praises? For me, it's physically even just lifting my hands and stretching out my body to say, God, everything that I am belongs to you. Yes, God. So as we start today, we're going to sing this familiar little tag of, we welcome you with praise, we welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We're in the house of God right now. I know that he doesn't need an invitation to the place where he belongs, but still he desires that we would have a heart of welcoming him with praise. So as we enter the presence of God, as we enter into this morning, let's just lift our voices. Let's sing that together. And let's welcome God here. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty God of love, be welcomed in this place. We welcome you with praise. We welcome you with praise. Almighty. Let every heart adore, let every
Oh, we are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Y'all came to worship today, didn't you? Love that. Love that. Well, we are going to worship, and it is right that there would be joy in the house of the Lord. When you understand that we, because of Jesus Christ, have forgiveness, acceptance, redemption by the blood of Jesus Christ, thank you, Lord. And so we've built in time this morning to reflect upon that, to remember that, and we're going to do that through communion. So if you've got a communion cup, it requires a little bit of prep. So go ahead and start working on that. If you're online, get some elements ready, because we're going to worship the Lord together. You know, on my computer, I get these little reminders. Don't forget to do this. And on my phone, I get, hey, you have an appointment. Don't forget about this. And sometimes my wife will say, hey, don't forget about that. Reminders are helpful, right? And that's what communion is. It's a reminder. But then I think about the ways that our enemy wants to remind us of things. Well, you're not all that. And you've done this, and you've done that, and don't forget how you failed, and don't forget how you came up short. And our enemy, Satan, is called the accuser of the brethren. But then there's a reminder that comes from our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who says, I know what you did too, and I know that you deserve punishment for it. And I also remember that my son, Jesus Christ, gave his very life. He shed his blood so that you could be forgiven. So communion this morning is an opportunity for us, the followers of Jesus Christ, to be reminded, to remember what Christ has done for us. And it is for everyone who is a follower of Jesus Christ. And if you're not yet there, I have not made that decision personally. I would encourage you to wait, to not participate in communion today. But we'd love to talk to you about that and the significance of hope found only in Jesus Christ. But we remember and we reflect. And so, Lord, thank you. We remember that you gave your body. It was broken for us. Remember him. And the Bible makes it very clear, if there's going to be forgiveness of sin, it only comes through the shedding of blood. And God made a way to replace the sacrificial altar with a table of fellowship and a table of communion, remembering Christ shed blood for the forgiveness of our sins. Remember together. All right, now let our remembrance flow into our worship. Don't forget this reminder of what Christ has done for us, all right? We're going to continue in worship together.
Of all that you are. took the altar in. You made it a table, and nothing can separate what you bring together.
Oh, I will remember.
Yes. He's the reason we're here today. Yes. Come on, church, let's give him a shout of praise this morning. Oh, sing Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. You're worthy of it all. Amen. Yes, amen. Church, it's great worshiping with you. Why don't we take a seat while we get ready for announcements?
Welcome to Harvest Bible Chapel Online. My name is Dave Learned, and I serve as one of the pastors on our Rolling Meadows campus. I'm really glad that you chose to join us today, and we'd absolutely love to know, where are you watching from today? You can let us know in the chat or in the comments. And whether this is your first time or whether you do this regularly, I really want to invite you to check in with us. You can do that right here on this page through a link in the comments on YouTube and Facebook, or you can use the Harvest Bible Chapel app. We'd love to know that you're here, because as a staff, we count it a privilege to pray for all of the prayer requests each week. So let us know how we can do that as you check in today. We want to help you too to engage in worship through giving, and there's a number of ways that you can do that as an act of worship today. You can give online on this page. You can use the QR code that's on this screen, or you can give through the Harvest Bible Chapel app, send in a text, or by mailing a gift to the Rolling Meadows campus. All of this is worship unto the Lord. We love what God's doing in our church through the Hope Centers and on the Rolling Meadows campus, the Elgin and Crystal Lake campuses. Our Hope Centers are open every Saturday morning from 10 a.m. to noon. It's for anyone who's in need of food or hygiene products. And in addition to the help we're able to provide, we also offer the hope of Jesus Christ. If you or someone you know could use some help, please invite them to come any Saturday to one of these locations to the Hope Center. Hey, as summer moves along, we're looking forward to getting together soon for some outdoor worship nights. These are awesome times. Bring a blanket, bring a chair, get together with your family and your friends from your campus for a night of worship with our worship team. And all of the dates and all of the details are available. You can go to harvestnow.info. This is also the last week that we're going to have Dr. Rydelnik with us. We're grateful for his teaching, and we continue to pray for him and his family as they serve the Lord and work for Christ. We're super excited, guys. Tomorrow, Dr. Jeff Buckham officially starts on our staff as our new lead teaching pastor. We've been praying for this and looking forward to a new chapter in our church and the ministry the Lord has for us. Next week, he'll be here to open God's word to all of us. Let's pray this week for Jeff and Jeannie and their whole family as they begin their ministry here at Harvest. Let's pray together now as we continue in worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are good, that you lead us, that you care for us, you provide for us. You have always been faithful to us. And so, Lord, now we just pray for Jeff and for Jeannie and for their family. Would you, Lord, help them as they settle in? Help them quickly to feel acclimated to a new place and a new church. Lord, would you just use them however you see fit to influence us to follow Christ with our whole heart? Lord, we're thankful for your care. We're thankful for each way that you lead us, particularly in care for our church. We're leaning in, excited to follow you, Lord, with all of the attention on Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.
From heaven you came running, there was mercy in your for why? For
yeah. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in.
We are here to worship, Lord. And that song is the gospel message. And Lord, I pray that we would receive that. I pray those souls who are lost here today would receive that. And God, that you would be so kind to just show your grace as you always do. And Lord, as we hear your word, would you speak to us all? In whatever way, Lord, would we just feel your spirit with us, Lord? In your holy in matchless name we pray. Amen. Amen, church. Yeah. It's great worshiping with you this morning. Why don't you take a seat?
Hey, everyone. Glad to see all of you. Wow. This is my last week with you. Got Jeff Bucknam coming, guys. Come on, everyone go, yay, yay. I'm really happy about that. I did want to say thank you to all of you and to all the campuses that are watching this now. I so appreciate the privilege I've had of getting to speak a number of times since the wintertime here with you at Harvest. And let me just say, I have been really touched and I'm grateful because I have hardly ever seen a congregation that so longs to know the Word of God and so wants to obey it. And so thank you for giving me the privilege of being able to talk with you about God's Word. So, and also I want to say thank you to my friend Mike Van Lanningham, who's on staff here at Harvest, because probably without him that would not have happened, I probably would not have spoken. So thank you, Mike, for having me. And if you're interested in ever hearing Mike and I teach together, a great way for Harvest to do that will be to go to Israel with us in about a year and a few months, in October of 2022. We've got an Israel trip planned, and believe it or not, it's filling up. And so if you're interested, Mike and I will be teaching through the land of Israel, and every site, it's sort of like a living classroom, where it happened. We're going to teach about what happened. And it's a great, great opportunity for anyone to go to Israel. And I think it's especially good to go with Mike V, who wears his Indiana Jones hat and lets everyone know what's happening at all places. So here's my question for you. What is the most unquoted, unused Bible promise? You know, people ask me Bible questions all the time, but I'm never asked, what's your Bible question? That's my Bible question. What is the Bible promise that people least cite or claim? The least claimed Bible promise. I'll tell you what it is. It's John 16:33. In this world, you will have trouble. That's a promise that Jesus made. And none of us wants to quote it. Do you ever notice that? We don't want to claim that promise, but it's really true. In this world, we will have trouble or tribulation. Maybe you noticed we're living in troubling times. There's a global pandemic that we're just barely coming out of now that has caused the death of millions across the globe and over 600,000 people here in the United States. Nationally, I believe our country is more divided than almost any time in its history since the Civil War. Between the racial division that sprung up or actually came to the surface with the death, the horrific death of George Floyd last year, the political division that has gotten worse and worse. I believe our national motto is being denied. E pluribus unum. No, no. Out of many, one. Out of many, many is what we have. Great deal of division. And frankly, congregationally, this congregation has experienced some troubled times. The year before the pandemic and then the pandemic coming right after that, people are still troubled. Many people dropped out for a variety of reasons, but it's been a troubling time for Harvest Bible Chapel. Personally, people have faced financial crises in the last year or two, interpersonal problems, health struggles. It's a troubling time. And for our family, the last year and a half, for Eva and me, have been especially challenging, very troubling. Just before the pandemic, Eva was diagnosed with cancer. It was her third major cancer, unrelated each time, or fourth major cancer. During the pandemic, she was on chemotherapy, and she and I had to be very, very careful because she had no immune system during that time. And just at the start of the summer, we felt we were coming out of that. Well, last summer, she then got sick. She got a kidney infection, ended up with sepsis, and almost died. The doctor said, good, you got her to the hospital. Most people don't make it to the hospital. And then June, she was diagnosed with another form of cancer. Unrelated again, and she's not here today because she's just recovering from surgery. Really, really tough time for us. The good news is none of those cancers are related, so there's no metastatic cancer. She just is apparently prone to cancer. But it's been hard, and during the trouble last year, when she was on chemo, when she got sepsis, a friend of mine gave me Psalm 77 to start meditating on. And it's really important that we have something to look at when we face troubling times. If you have ever had a troubled heart, and troubling times like this cause troubled hearts, cause hearts that are disappointed with God, become hearts that become disillusioned with our faith, with our walk with God. When that happens, we need encouragement. So my friend gave me Psalm 77. I don't know if you've ever had this experience. I read Psalm 77 and I said, was that in the Bible before? You know? I don't remember ever reading that before, but it so spoke to my heart, and I have been living in Psalm 77 this past year. It's a passage that's really, really meaningful to me. And for that reason, since this is my last week, and I know that Pastor Bucknam, Pastor Jeff, is going to be finishing the book of Ephesians, and so I thought he could start in Ephesians 5, and I want to help us all be encouraged by reading and studying and looking at Psalm 77 with you, which I've called a song for troubled hearts. In this psalm, written by Asaph, if you know who Asaph is, it says at the top, a psalm of Asaph. Asaph was a musician, a good psalmist who wrote several psalms. He served as a musician in the reigns of both King David and King Solomon. I don't know what was distressing him or what was distressing Israel, but he gives a great model for how to respond to trying times and troubled hearts. What should we do when we have troubled hearts? This passage gives us three ways, this song gives us three ways to respond to troubled hearts. So here's what I'd like to do. I'd like to read the whole psalm. And why don't we stand together and open your Bibles to Psalm 77. I'll read, you follow along, reading from the ESV. And in verse 10, I'm going to read the footnote instead of the text. Okay? So if you say, where is it coming from? I'm reading the ESV footnote. Okay? I cry aloud to God, and he will hear me. In the day of my trouble, I seek the Lord. In the night, my hand is stretched out without wearying. My soul refuses to be comforted. When I remember God, I moan. When I meditate, my spirit faints. You hold my eyelids open. I am so troubled, I cannot speak. I consider the days of old, the years long ago. I said, let me remember my song in the night. Let me meditate in my heart. Then my spirit made a diligent search. Will the Lord spurn forever and never again be favorable? Has his steadfast love forever ceased? Are his promises at an end for all time? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he in anger shut up his compassion? This is my grief, that the right hand of the Most High has changed. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. I will ponder all your work and meditate on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is great like our God? You are the God who works wonders. You have made known your might among the peoples. You, with your arm, redeemed your people, the children of Jacob and Joseph. When the waters saw you, O God, when the waters saw you, they were afraid. Indeed, the deep trembled. The clouds poured out water. The skies gave forth thunder. Your arrows flashed on every side. The crash of your thunder was in the whirlwind. Your lightnings lighted up the world. The earth trembled and shook. Your way was through the sea. Your path through the great waters. Yet, your footprints were unseen. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. Have a seat. This psalm, as I said, gives us three ways that those of us, when we have troubled hearts, can respond to God. Three steps, I guess, we could take. The first one is this. We need to express our troubled hearts to God in prayer. If you look at verses 1 through 10, this is his prayer. He talks all these things about, I cry aloud, I seek the Lord, I stretch out my hand, I remember, I meditate, so forth. And you see his prayer in verses 1 through 10. And I made two quick observations, not to reread each verse there that we just read, two quick observations. First, when I look at this prayer by Asaph, it tells me that we need to pray with persistence. We need to pray with persistence. Take a look at all the words about prayer. Verse 1, I cry aloud. In verse 2, I seek the Lord. In verses 3 and 6, he says, I remember God, I meditate. What I find is that when we get into these down places, these distressed situations, these difficult circumstances, when we're downcast, the last thing we want to do is pray. Have you ever noticed that? It's like, no, I do not want to talk to you, God. It's because when we pray, we feel as if no one is listening. Like we're talking to the ceiling, so we quit. But this passage gives us the example of persistent prayer. In fact, many of the Hebrew verbs where he expresses his prayer, is a form in Hebrew that expresses determination. These forms, they're used repeatedly, 3 or 4 times in the verbs. I looked it up in the advanced Hebrew grammar just to make sure I remember my grammar right, and it's the grammar actually says that this verb form expresses the direction of the will to action and denotes self-encouragement or resolution. Resolution. I will cry out to God. In the day of my trouble, I will seek the Lord. This is determination, persistence. No matter how it feels, we still have to seek God. Sometimes we don't want to. You know, we think of classic for my culture, I don't want to be a nudge, you know, I don't want to bother God. Then there's the other thing. I once heard a comedian talk about how God's busy with important things, not our stupid stuff. Don't bother telling God about our troubles. Tell my friend Rudy. He doesn't have a job. He can listen. But God does intensely care. He deeply cares. Tim Stafford, who I recently reread his chapter about prayer in the book Knowing the Face of God, tells us that we need to persist. And this is what he says. We don't pray to tell God what he does not know, because he knows. Nor to remind him of things that he has forgotten. He already cares for the things we pray about. His attention to them has never flagged from the beginning, and his understanding is unfathomable. He has simply been waiting for us to care about these things with him. And then he gives the example of persistent prayer in the life of his grandfather, who was a missionary, Presbyterian missionary, who had a stroke. And for 10 years of his life, he lost his ability to speak. He could speak. His brain was coherent. He could think. But when he spoke, the circuitry going from his brain to speech came out as gibberish. So he knew what he was saying, but no one understood. He was just speaking gibberish. And also, when he wrote, he just wrote random letters. He couldn't write coherent words. It was gibberish. But he understood everything. Imagine how frustrating that would be. But what his grandfather could do for those last 10 years of his life, when called upon, he could pray. He could stand up and lead in beautiful, coherent prayer. That was the only thing he could do. They thought it was a miracle. But the doctor said that what had happened is he had been so faithful and so persistent in prayer that the circuits running from the brain, the prayer circuits he was using for prayer, to his speech were not affected by the stroke. That was a man who was persistent and faithful in prayer, no matter what happened. Oh, that should be us. That we pray, even in troubled times, so persistently that it will never be affected or hurt. We will pray. The second aspect of this prayer that I think is so crucial is that we need to pray with transparency. We need to be honest with God in prayer. Look at the psalmist here and how he is transparent with God. It says in verse 2 that he refused to be comforted when he prayed. That's a choice. I don't want comfort. He says that when he thinks of God, he moans. His spirit faints. He says he is so troubled, he can't speak. Then he expresses all his doubts in verses 7 through 10. He says, he wonders, will God spurn him forever? Will he never, ever again show grace or be favorable? Has his loyal love ceased forever? That's what steadfast love, loyal love. He's really saying, has God's loyal love proven to be disloyal? Are his promises at an end? Has God forgotten to be gracious? Has he ceased being compassionate? Imagine how he feels. Have you ever felt that way? Getting rocked and rocked and rocked and thinking, God, this is not the God I signed up for. Doesn't feel like it, at least. And then verse 10, which I'm not sure why the ESV translates the way it does, but the footnote is right. In verse 10, it says, this is my grief. It's actually, this is my piercing. This is what has pierced me. That the right hand of the Most High, that means his strength, that the right hand of the Most High has changed. That it doesn't exist anymore. That there is no strength from God. I look at this prayer and I think, wow, that is honesty before God. And sometimes we think God can't, well, we don't want to have that kind of honesty with God. Why is that? I think of the movie A Few Good Men. There's that climactic scene when Jack Nicholson, the character he plays, looks at the attorney and he says, you can't handle the truth. That's what we think when we're praying. God, I'd like to tell you this, but you can't handle the truth. He absolutely can handle it. He wants us to express our prayers this way. He wants us to be open with him. Now, you say, wait a minute, but Job, he got in trouble for doing that. Job got in trouble for demanding that God answer him. That's what Job got in trouble for. Asaph isn't demanding answers. He is just expressing his pain. And God longs for that. God wants that. We need to be honest, transparent in prayer. God is powerful enough and loving enough to want to hear the heartbreak of his children. He wants to hear it. And I think we need to express it. Let's not become sanctimonious in prayer. Let's be honest in prayer. When our hearts are broken, we need to express that to God. When we're disappointed with him, he needs to hear it. He wants to hear it. And we need to express it. So, first step when we are troubled hearts is we need to express our troubled hearts to God in prayer. We need to keep praying. We need to pray honestly. Secondly, we need to meditate on God's powerful works as revealed in Scripture, as recorded in God's Word. The reason I say that, look at verses 11 and 12. He says, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. I will remember your wonders. I will ponder all your work. Notice he's looking at all God's works. I will meditate on your mighty deeds. The word meditate is exactly the same word that's used in Psalm 1 about the man of God who meditates on God's word day and night. Now think about this. Asaph is remembering. He's pondering. He's meditating on all God's great deeds. And then when you keep reading from verse 13 onward, what he's talking about is the exodus from Egypt and the parting of the Red Sea. Now, so what is he remembering, pondering, and meditating on? He's thinking about the exodus. And this is crucial. Asaph lived 400 years after the Exodus. It's not part of his experience. It's not part of his memory. How does he know about the Exodus? How does he ponder and meditate on these things? From God's Word. He's reading the book of Exodus, and he's seeing God's outstretched arm, God's powerful hand saving Israel. That's what he's doing. He is in the Word of God. If we want to understand God's true character of love when we feel troubled by his actions, when we feel he has abandoned us, what we need to do is go back to the Word. We need to keep reading what God has done. Now, obviously, Asaph went back and read Israel's, great redemption event, the Exodus, passing through the Red Sea. But we have an even greater redemption event, one that foreshadowed. We know about how the Messiah has come and died for us and rose again and delivered us from sin. We need to go back and read in Scripture God's great deliverance. We need to keep in the Word of God, not quit. Of course, what we do when we're hurt, when we're broken, kind of close this book up. We say, well, I'm going to put that away for now. I'm just going to watch TV. No, we need to read the Scriptures. I got a new car in February. Pretty cool car, a Subaru. It's got so much electronic gadgetry. They come standard. It's like, wow, nothing seemed to work. Nothing. I'm plugging things. It's supposed to have the Apple thing work. No, not working. It's supposed to have the garage door go up and down by pushing. Nothing worked. I thought, I'm going to take this car back. The gadgetry doesn't work. Then Eva made this really good suggestion. Why don't you check the manual? So there I am sitting in the car with the manual. Oh, that's how you do that. All of a sudden, everything's working. Do you know what that was? Operator error. That's the words, the two words. Operator error. I didn't understand the car, so therefore, I wasn't using it right. When we have these terrible, troubling times, we stop understanding the true nature of God. We think he's forgotten to be gracious. We think he doesn't care. We think he won't show compassion anymore. We think his strength has abated, right? Where are we going to find out where God really loves us? Where are we going to find out about his true nature and his true character? We need to read the manual. We need to read the manual. So the second way we respond, prayer, read the word about God's great deliverance. Third step is we need to recognize God's different path through troubled times. In verses 13 through 19, it describes God's way, God's path. And what I looked at that is that is not the path I would choose, but God's path is different. God's way is distinctive. It is just not at all what I would choose. But he chooses it, and he's got a purpose for it and a plan in it. And it's different than any of us would choose. So I would like to look with you about five distinct characteristics of God's path, God's way. And the first one we need to look at is in verse 13, God's way is holy. See what it says there in verse 13? Your way, O God, is holy. What God is great like our God? The word holy, which does have the sense of righteousness, and I think we need to remember that when we have troubled hearts, we tend to want to accuse God, and this verse is affirming that God's way, no matter how it is, it's righteous. It's without sin. It is wholly separate from sin. It is holy. But it also has this sense of being distinctive. When we think of the word holy in Hebrew, it means not just apart from sin, but distinctive, separated. That's why basins in the tabernacle could be said to be holy, an inanimate object, because it is distinct, separated out just for service in the tabernacle. So when it says your way is holy, it's not just saying it's without sin. It is saying that it's set apart or distinctive, that it's different than what we would expect. This is not the path that we would choose, we sometimes think. Even I often say, this is not what we would choose. This is not the path we would have chosen for the last 2 years. But it is God's holy and distinctive path that he chose for us. It's his path. And because of that, we have to keep reminding ourselves, God's way is holy. He's got a different kind of plan for us. And I keep finding comfort from a quote from the letters of John Newton. don't know if you know who John Newton was. He wrote Amazing Grace. Here's what he said. Let us suppose the thing we are most afraid of actually happens. Can it come a moment sooner or in any other way than by his appointment? That's his path. Is he not gracious and faithful to support us under the stroke? Is he not rich enough to give us something better than ever he will take away? Is not the light of his countenance better than life and its most valued enjoyments? Every time we see God's path is different, distinctive, we need to be reminded that it's a good path. Not the one we'd have chosen, but he did. Second, God's way is powerful. If you look at verses 14 and 15, God is the one who works wonders. You make your might known among the peoples, and you redeem the children of Israel. It's going to talk about how scary it gets even further in verses 14 and 15. But here is emphasizing his power. Where it says in verse 15, with your arm, that refers to God's strength. With his arm, you redeemed your people. I think what this is thing for us to see is that sometimes we're in troubling circumstances, difficult times, just to see how powerful he is. Every time the Lord delivers us from troubling times, it's another evidence of his great power. Things that are impossible, he delivers us. And we get reminded of his great power. This last cancer was Eva's fifth major cancer in 29 years. Each of them different and each one cured. Now, why do I mention this? A friend of mine wrote saying he was praying while Eva was in the hospital and said, sorry to hear about Eva's new bout with cancer. On the bright side, her pursuit of the record for cancer recovery seems to be going well. And that's true. Every time we think, well, this is it. In fact, the very first time, it was stage four, and they said she had about a year to live. That was 29 years ago. I had two little boys. I just didn't know what I was going to do. God was powerful in delivering her, and he keeps powerfully delivering her. People, let's look back at our lives. Every time, this is not the first time we've had troubled hearts, is it? This is not the first difficulties we've ever faced. Has God not been faithful, showing his strength to bring us through? God's way is powerful, and it's done this way to remind us just how powerful he is. Third, God's way is often through danger. Look at verses 16 through 19. It talks about the flooding of the water saw you. This is the waters of the Red Sea. The deep trembled. And though the text doesn't say in Exodus that the sky had this terrible rainstorm and the crash of the thunder and the lightnings, which are mentioned in verses 17 and 18, it does say in Exodus 14 that the Egyptian army was terrified when they began to see what was going on. And I think it was because not just was the sea going to part, but that there was all these other events happening, the lightning and the thunder. And this was a scary time, not just for Israel, but for the Egyptian army, if you can imagine it. And it seemed dangerous. As dangerous and terrifying as it was, it says, your way was through the sea and your path through the great waters. I can't imagine what it's like. We think danger, when we go to a dangerous path or a troubling path, that it's random, meaningless, that just these things happen. They don't just happen. They're part of God's path. He puts us on a dangerous path. I can't imagine that. They're not random. We talked about, Eve and I were talking about this, about how scary this last event was. And she quoted, she teaches a course in C.S. Lewis, and she quoted to me from Mere Christianity, "Why now? Because God is forcing him on or up to a higher level, putting him into situations where he will be very much, where he will need to be very much braver or more patient or more loving than he ever dreamed of being before. It seems to us all unnecessary, but that is because we have not yet had the slightest notion that the tremendous thing he is doing, the tremendous thing he means to make us into." That's what it says. So we go on a dangerous path, every one of us, and these events happen, and we think, what's going on? Where are you, God? And he is saying, this is what I am doing, so you can see how powerful I am, and you can rely on me, and he's going to bring us through. He wants to transform us by trusting him through dangerous paths. It's frightening, but it's true, and we need to have a bit more, we have to be very much braver, is what he says, what C.S. Lewis said. Fourth, God's way is hidden. That's the end of verse 19. I love this. It says, "Yet your footprints were unseen." God led Israel through the Red Sea. He led them, right? There were no footprints. It's not like he was going in front of them and you could see, oh, there's the footprints. And when I read that, I thought of that old poster about footprints. You know, when was there one set of footprints, right? That was when I carried you. That's not what this passage is saying. It's saying you couldn't even see the footprints, but I do have a more favorite view of that footprints poster. It's, "My child, I never left you. Those places with one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you. But that long groove over there is when I dragged you for a while." The second part, that's me. But this passage is actually saying his footprints were unseen. Think about it. It's like having GPS or Waze or Google Maps, right? Imagine Israel. We've got the Google Maps on our iPhones, and they're going through the wilderness, and they notice we're up against the Red Sea. And by the way, the Egyptian army is right behind us, the mighty Egyptian army. And they start going, I don't think these Google Maps, this GPS isn't working. This is not the path I would choose. And we think God is leading us. Where's that pillar of cloud and pillar of fire? Why did it bring us here? His footprints were unseen, but he is leading us nonetheless. As we go through troubling times, we need to remember that the GPS is indeed working, that God's leading is really working. He sees the entire picture. In the last battle, King Tyrion says, "We must go on and take the adventure that comes to us. But courage, child, we are all between the paws of the true Aslan." That's how we go through it. He leads us, but his footprints are unseen. And then lastly, God uses people. It says in verse 20, "You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron." God indeed led Israel through the Red Sea. You couldn't see his footprints, but whose footprints did you see? Moses and Aaron. God uses people in troubling times to be the ones that will encourage us. God always uses people. We need to make ourselves available to those who are going through tough times. We need to be the ones, we need to be Moses and Aaron to them, help them through it. God gave us some really terrific people to do that with us. I'm sure in your own life, when you've gone through troubling times, there are people that have jumped in. We need to choose to do that too. And we also need to receive the fact that people want to help us. When we're going through troubled times, receive it. Don't do the, "I am a rock, I'm an island." God's people are there for us to help us through. God uses people. God's way uses people. Here's what Psalm 77 is saying. When our hearts are troubled, we need to keep on praying. We need to keep on reading Scripture. We need to keep on following God's path. That's what Psalm 77 is saying. Don't quit. So, now what? Some real quick takeaways. First of all, if you're in a troubled time right now, or if you ever go through them, keep praying honestly. Don't quit, even when you don't feel like it, even when you feel those prayers are bouncing off the ceiling. Keep praying honestly. Secondly, stay in the Word of God. Stay in fellowship where the Word of God is taught. Stay in the Word of God. It is the sole source of input that's true in all ways. Stay in the Word. And third, receive encouragement by reviewing God's past rescues in our lives. Obviously, they thought of the Exodus. We think of redemption from sin, right? We need to keep reviewing that. We need to go over that. But I want to suggest that we each, if you've never done it before, now's the time to go back and think through all the times God delivered us and brought us through in the past. Write them down. And from now on, always write them down. It is the most encouraging thing to go back and see all the ways that God has showed his strength and power through really scary times in the past. Look at God's actions in the past and receive encouragement from that. Okay, now I want you to quote from my all-time favorite movie. You can do it with me. Actually, it's probably my third all-time favorite movie, The Wizard of Oz. We're going down the path that God has put us on. Troubling times, difficult paths. What's on these paths? Ready? Lions and tigers and bears. Lions and tigers and bears. Lions and tigers and bears. That's what the path seems like, doesn't it? Filled with lions and tigers and bears, right? Living in this world will put us on scary paths. Remember this. There's someone who is always present. Maybe unseen, but absolutely present with us, who's leading us on this path. One of my wife's favorite verses is Psalm 25:10. All the paths of the Lord, even the ones with lions and tigers and bears, even the ones that are frightening, even the ones we dread the most, all the paths of the Lord are loving kindness and truth. Psalm 25:10. Let's pray together. God in heaven, we thank you, Father, that you are a powerful God who's strong, who's able to bring us through these paths, and that you use your people to encourage us. Oh God, I just pray for each one here. If they're not going through a troubling time, they have gone through them or will go through them. If their hearts are not troubled now, they will have troubled hearts. Oh Lord, for those who are struggling right now, help us to see your strength and your power in your word and in our lives. Oh God, bring us through this difficult path. We thank you for that, that you did it through our Lord Jesus. We give you praise in his name. Amen.
Understand, and I don't always get to see, but I will believe it. Yes, I will believe it. You make mountains move. You make giants fall. You use songs of praise to shake prison walls. I will speak to my fear. I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then. You'll be faithful now. Standing on your word, calling heaven down to earth. You will fight my enemies. This will end in victory. Yes, I will believe it.
Together today. I'm so glad you joined us. And I want to invite you to come back next Sunday morning at 9 a.m., 11 a.m. Central Time. And if you're ready and you live in the Chicagoland area, I want to personally invite you to come. We'd love to see you in person. Every week we're seeing new people come back, and we'd love to have you join us for worship in person next Sunday. You are loved.